when I first moved to Mount Shasta in 79, I'm driving these back roads all the time, and Old Stage Road is just a gravel road. There was only like one house in this whole valley, and I would park right out there by Old Stage Road where College Avenue comes down, and I would look right over here where this house is sitting, and I would just stare at this place, and I said, oh, if I wanted to live anywhere in this county, I would love to live right there. And I'd point my finger from out there on the road right at this place. My dad was a logger, his dad was a logger, and my grandfather learned, his name was Alec. And he was logging in northern Minnesota, and they logged the horses. And my dad was like 10, 11 years old. He begged his dad to take him out, and my grandfather to take him out in the woods. My grandfather, they cut the trees down with a misery whip and, you know, chop down the undercut and then use a misery whip and cut them down. So my grandfather used to carry a little cruiser's axe for limbing the trees. So he told my dad, he said, well, you be really careful because they're sharp. And my grandfather kept them as sharp as a razor. My grandfather cut a tree down, and my dad was going along, and it was the middle of winter time. He took a swing at one of the limbs, and the wood is frozen, and that cruiser's axe bounced off the limb and came right down across my dad's shin and cut it right to the bone. Ooh. Just laid it wide open. Well, my dad didn't want to tell his dad because he didn't want to make him quit. So my grandfather was working over there a little ways from my dad. My dad said, I'm not going to tell my dad. And so he took another swing at the limb again, and it glanced off again and came right above the other cut. Same thing, cut right to the bone. So my dad's bleeding bad, so he had to tell my grandfather. So we went over, and my grandfather was Swedish, and I can't speak a Swedish brogue, but my grandfather did. He had real broken Swedish. But he said to my dad, he said, well, little man, you've got the sap of the spruce in your veins. Now you'll be in the woods the rest of your life. Just what he told him. So anyhow, I was about 15, and my dad fixed up an old chainsaw. And my saw kicked back and came right across my leg. Cut me right to the bone. The chainsaw just went right. We didn't have chaps in those days. Yeah. Cut me right to the bone. So my boot was filling up with blood, and I looked over at my dad. I said, I'm going to have to tell him. So I went over because I knew it was cut. I mean, I looked down there and just raw flesh down there. Chainsaws are really hard on your body. So I walked over. I mean, he looked at me. He grinned and said, well, Ross, you got the sap of the pine tree in you. You'll be in the woods the rest of your life. That's a true story.
Oh,
true
that's
story.
So awesome.
In fact, when I was out in the woods with my dad when I was a little guy, he said, always try to leave a tree in the place of one you cut. And that's what I've always tried to do.
I got the sap of the pine tree in me. That's how I got into the logging. I started working with my dad. He started teaching me how to fall trees. This is that's some of the trees. That's a Doug Fir I cut.
This
sugar pine there I cut. This was all down the Klamath River. This is my brother and I. We were jacking trees. We put four rims in and had to jack. So we'd have to jack them. That was my mom and my brother and I here. They came out in the woods one day. Fir, big Doug Fir, that's a big sugar pine. There's a sugar pine there. So the biggest one I ever cut was 8'4" in diameter.
Wow.
Sugar pine was 8'4". And this was about the second biggest one I ever cut.
Is that you, Ross?
That's me when I was a young buck. Yep, I mean, that was him. He's about 6 foot tall. His arms were about, he was so strong. His hands were just massive.
Popeye arms
and shoulders, and his hands were just massive just from running, you know. Axe and a misery whip, you know, everything's now, it's not like it was before, you know, now it's different because I log in, I gotta work on equipment. It's not quite the same as just going out and falling trees all day. And so you come back smelling greasy, you look greasy, that's not as much fun. You don't smell there as good either. I was working with my dad and my uncle, and we were working down for Snyder Lumber Products. I fell a big tree, and it was a, and it's called a school marm, which means it's a double top tree. And when I fell it, I could see one of the school marms, one of the tops, was wrapped around through these oak trees. And I thought, that's really dangerous. I got to really be careful, because this is going to be really hard to deal with. But the other school marm, I could see that it didn't have any pressure on it. I didn't think it had any pressure on it. So I thought, okay, I'll buck this one out of the way, then I'll be free to be out of the way for the other one, then I can cut it so it's not so dangerous. Well, I was cutting down through this side of the tree, one side of the forks, and I'm not kidding you. I heard a voice. It said, get out of the way. I thought, get out of the way. And it was over the sound of the chainsaw. And I stopped. And I looked behind me like that. Who said that? And I said, wow, Ross, you're hearing things. You're losing it, buddy.
Yeah.
And I wasn't a Christian at the time. And, you know, I didn't know anything about spiritual things at all. I was as dumb as a fence post. And so I started my saw again, but I thought, you know, I better move out of the way. I'm going to listen to this voice, wherever this voice came from. So I moved over a little bit. And, you know, I was holding my chainsaw, and I had a big, heavy 075 steel chainsaw. So I moved over like that, and I started cutting again, started the chainsaw again, and I didn't cut that far. And I heard the voice say again, I said, get out of the way. I said, wow.
Whoa.
I thought, man, I am really losing it.
That's incredible.
I've never heard voices in my life. I mean, never, ever. I didn't hear voices. I didn't go around hearing voices. I mean, it did not happen. So I changed hands, which is really awkward to do when you change hands with something.
Yeah.
And I changed hands, and I reached over as far as away from them as I could, and I just started my saw and just cut a little more wood, and that tree exploded. Oh. I didn't see it. It had sidebind also. I just couldn't see it.
Yeah.
Or I wasn't looking good enough. The other one was so bad that I didn't realize this other one had all this pent-up pressure, and that tree snapped sideways. The log snapped sideways, smashed into the side of my hip, flew back, knocked me over backwards. My chainsaw landed on top of me.
Oh my God.
But I was out of the way far enough,
yeah,
that it shoved the saw into me and knocked me down and threw me over backwards. But if I hadn't moved either times, this log that was in, it was still 75 feet, it's 50, 75 feet long, it probably weighed 2,000 pounds. That log would have came right across my lap and caught me right in the lap and broke me in half. Absolutely broke me in half, because it went about 10 feet behind me.
Oh my God.
And it exploded. And I, you know what? I got up and I picked up my saw. And I said, you're pretty smart. True story. I said, Ross, you're really listening. But then I stopped. And I said, I wonder if somebody's up there looking after me. And I looked up like that and I said, if that was somebody up there, thank you. So that's what got me on thinking about eternity. And I thought, you know, what would have happened to me if I would have been killed? Would I just be in a hole in the ground? Or was there something more than this life?
Right.
And was there been, what about my emotions? What about my love? What about my feelings and everything? Would that just be the end?
Yeah.
And so that started making me think about things. Well, maybe there is a God. So that was that's my first encounter with the...
Wow.
Amazing where I should have been killed, because I should have been killed there. Yeah, this is all parts for breaking chains down. I buy the chain by 100 foot roll. Oh, we go through 500 feet a year.
Yeah, I got chainsaws everywhere, Autumn.
And this is a ladder, my infamous ladder I fell off of my loft. I was over here, I was right there, and I went right there.
Right on the concrete,
solid concrete, and shattered my hip.
Oh boy.
So you fall from that height. The fall's not bad, it's a stop, it's a sudden stop that's the problem.
Yeah, that's the problem. You're no stranger to busting yourself up.
I'm all about pain and hurt. Yeah. So
oh
I broke that
God.
Hip, I broke my lower leg, and I cut my leg. Then I cut my leg again down here. And then I broke my skull, and then I broke some ribs. And then I fell out of the loft and broke my pelvis, and I broke this hip at the same time. Other than that, I haven't done any damage. If you wanted to hear more. So we had a flat tire, one of the skidders. Unfortunately, we'd left a spare clear down at the bottom of the hill. Well, the problem was, it was about 3 miles away, And instead of going the longer route, where it was a safer, flatter road, I was in a hurry. I jumped on the loader. I took off. The problem was the road had an outslope to it. And on the downhill slope, it was steep bank like that and went straight down into a clear cut. And like an idiot, you never get too old to be stupid. I thought I was coming down the road and I dropped it in the second gear and that was fine. But I got down the road, further down the road, and I could see the skidder tire. I said, oh, that's good. It's not very far away now. I'll just go into third gear and I'll just cruise on down there. Well, just the time I hit third gear, I hit a rough section of the road where the front end of the loader, and I started speeding up and it started bouncing. And I hit the brakes and the engine stalled. Oh. And when the engine stalls, you lose your steering. I hit this rough section of the road and the whole front end bounced over like that. I hit the brake. No, there was still brakes, but it seized up on one side and sucked the whole loader over the edge. And all of a sudden, I'm airborne going over the hill. And this loader is, I mean, it's going fast. And it just goes right off of this bank, like a steep bank like that. And my dad had ever told me, he said, if you get in a machine and it's going, you get out of it because it will roll over the top of you and crush you. It'll throw you out on the downhill side. And I'm telling you, I remember my dad in that instant that I was going airborne over this bank. And it was steep like this. I don't know how I got up and out of that loader as it was going over this bank, but I dove out of it, and when I dove out, I hit the tire, and it threw me in the air, and I landed face down into the rocks.
Oh my gosh.
And the loader went on down the mountainside and went for 200 yards straight off of this bank, and then when Luke got to me, my face was, my glasses were gone, this eye was swollen shut, I was covered in blood all over my face because I'd cut my glasses. I had safety glasses on and they cut all the way around my face and all the way to the bone.
Wow.
And he thought my eye was gone. And I just had eye surgery 2 months before for a detached retina in this same eye. And so he thought I was lost my eye totally, but I recovered from that too. I took about 2 or 3 days of work off. And
oh my God.
Yeah, that's a loader story.
They had it all be sharpened this way and this way and this way, and even the raker in the middle had to be sharpened. But it takes so long to sharpen it. I had to bring it home every night because my partner didn't know anything about sharpening it.
I was working down the Klamath River, and this happened in 1988. And there was a tree leaning in another one that was, it's called a boot sprung. All the roots were exposed, and the wind had pushed it into another tree. So I crippled up the tree in the back, put an undercut in it, back cut it, corner cut it, so it wouldn't barber chair, which splits up the middle. And then I started following this dug furrows in front. And I've done it lots of times. You just be sure you're safe. You get out of the way as it goes. The whole thing gets started and you just get out of the way. Well, everything was going fine. But what I didn't see right in front, or I didn't pay attention to, right in front of the tree behind was leaning, just like they were leaning like this.
Yeah.
I was following the tree in front. And this one was leaning over. Right in front of it was a small cedar. And it had a little hook to it. We call it a dog leg in the cedar. It grows up and it's been damaged and it's got a little hook in it.
Yeah.
When all the trees came down, the tree in back came right down and came right across that dog leg of that little cedar. And the cedar is probably about that big around. And it smashed it over sideways. And I had backed away. I was in a safe place, I thought. And I was watching the whole thing go, and this cedar came slamming down and caught me, blindsided me, and came right down across my skull.
Oh my gosh.
And pile drove me into the ground. I was watching everything go, and all of a sudden, I just got slammed to the ground. And I got to my feet, and I staggered around, and I said, I didn't know what happened.
Still conscious?
I was conscious. I was knocked out, but then I got to my feet, and I put my hand on my head, and there was blood on my hand. I didn't know what happened. My hard hat was gone. I just knew that a bomb had gone off, and all of a sudden, I'm staggering around going, what hit me? And all I could do was go, Jesus, I need your help. And there's a verse in Psalms 50, verse 15. That's a promise. God said, call upon me in your day of trouble. I will answer you. I will deliver you. And you will glorify me.
Yeah.
And they got me on a stretcher, got me down the landing. And I was just started throwing up the whole time. And just, they were just, they said, we got to get a helicopter. Well, they had told Tom Sheridan was here, and they had just, Donna got a call. The Ross is hurt. They're getting an ambulance down there. Tom Sheridan, he said, Donna, don't worry about it. If it was really serious, they'd put him on a helicopter. She got a call 30 seconds later. They're bringing the helicopter.
Oh,
okay. They were getting off, taking me off. I said, my pastor has to pray for me. And we had our pastor here. Larry Miniger was our pastor here in Weed. And so they said, this could be the dying man's last request, because they knew I had a serious injury. So they said, let's wait till this pastor gets here. So they were prepping me for surgery, shaving my hair off and everything. And Donna got there and pastor got there. They anointed me with oil, came into the prep room where they're shaving all my hair off. And the neurosurgeon told Donna, he told her separately, he said, I got it. He only has minutes to live. I got to get him into surgery. All of a sudden, I was not in that place. I was not in that hospital. I was somewhere else. I didn't have an out-of-body experience. But all I can say, I was standing up in a room, and it was a room that was surrounded. I had a mist all around me, like a fog,
yeah,
or a mist. It was like a mist. And I was standing in this room. It was just like in here. And there was a curtain. I can still see it. There was a curtain right in front of me. It was a veil, like a veil.
Yeah.
And I was standing, looking at this veil, and it was so peaceful. There was no pain. I was looking at that veil, and the voice said, what do you want to do, Ross? And I remember thinking, what do I want to do?
Yeah.
What, you know, and I thought, how can that be my decision? What do I want to do? And the voice again said, what do you want to do, Ross? And I remember thinking, behind that veil is eternity. The throne of God is just the other side of this veil. I mean, I could just sense it. And I looking at that veil, and I was thinking, I want to go through, and all of a sudden, in my mind's eye, you ever see cartoon figures where they'll see little bubbles going up, and then there's a picture of someone? That's what I saw. In my mind's eye, I saw my wife, Donna, and I saw my two sons, Adam and Luke, and I just knew. I got them to take care of.
Yeah.
And I remember saying, I've got my family to take care of. And like that, I was gone.
Really?
I was gone from that place. I can tell the story about when my dad cut all his toes off.
Oh, yeah.
I was a baby. I was 2 years old. And my dad did the logging and got done up in the Sierras. He had a chance to go to work over on the coast. The first day, he had a brand new pair of boots. And this was a huge thing because, you know, times were tight back then. So this was 66 years ago, 67 years ago. My dad went to work the first day, and he broke an axe. His accidentally got a crack in it, or it was broken. So he borrowed an axe from a friend of his that he was working with, and it had a long handle, which my dad usually cut the handle off of the end of his axe because he didn't want the handle sticking out too far. Well, they kept their axes really, really sharp for chopping the undercuts out.
Yeah.
So my dad took a swing at this undercut, but it was this long-handled axe, and the end of it hit the tree, and it deflected, and it came down, and it came right across his foot, right there, left foot, and sliced right through his boot, right down through the sole, and it laid his whole toe of his boot and all of his toes in the toe of the boot, just like that. And we almost starved to death, because he was off work for a year. And they had to stitch his toes back on. They never could stitch his big toe back on. They stitched his four other toes back on. And his big toe was so pulverized that they couldn't put it back on. And so he lived the rest of his life with just the four toes, which really crippled him up. Yeah, but we survived. I mean, we made it.
And it was a little tough going back to work, too, because that toe, I really did miss that big toe. It was gone.
Anyhow, we were down there and found out my dad was dying. Of course, he's my best friend, you know.
Yeah.
and I was falling trees up on the backside of Mount Shasta, and a song came into my heart. I mean, I've never written a song like this. And I took my hard hat off. I had a pencil in my pocket. And I said, "Right, I'm so glad you're my father. I'm so proud to be your son. And though the years will come and go, the memories will stay, because I've kept them in my heart, and they'll never slip away." Something like that.
Yeah. Oh, brother.
Some tough old logger I am. Some of crusty old logger I am.
Good old baby.
From the heart.
We love you.